St. Stephen United Methodist Church. I'm glad y'all are here. It's a joy to see you. And hope y'all enjoy our service today. Looks like a few of our members still may be trying to find their way back from some football game or just got lost on the way back from their TV. I don't know, but at any rate, I'm glad y'all are here. Those of you watching online, we are glad you're with us as well. We welcome you. We want you to feel a part of everything. I don't think I've said it the last couple of weeks, but if you will send us your email address, we'll be more than happy to include you in our mail list. You'll get a weekly bulletin, and that's important because it contains the lyrics to the hymns we're singing. And the words, any readings we're doing, like our statement of faith or Holy Communion, it'll help you feel like you're a part of our congregation, whether you're here with us or watching virtually. So the contact information is on our Facebook page. It's also on our YouTube page. So you can call us and leave us a message, or you can email us and let us know how to send that bulletin to you. This morning I added some new, or actually not new, but some unused welcome packets to the table out in the narthex. So the next time we have a visitor, if one of you would be so kind as to introduce yourself and make sure that they get one of those little welcome packets. It's very simple. It's just a welcome card and a request for their information so that we can thank them for joining us. And it would be a great help to get those to any visitors that we have. Also, I want to remind everybody about the new Sunday school or study class that started last week. And so it's been going for 2 weeks now. It starts at 10 in the morning. Otis facilitates it, but it's not a lecture class. It's more of a sharing and discussion class on scripture and the issues of living in a relationship with God. So it's been very good so far, and we would encourage y'all to join the class. I want to remind everybody about our Must Ministries jar. If you would like to contribute to Must, you can put money in the jar. Or if you prefer, if you're writing a check for your offering, you can just put an amount on the designation line that's supposed to go to Must, and we'll make sure it gets where it's supposed to go. Glad you're with us. Hope you enjoy the service today, and we're going to proceed with our first scripture reading.
We're reading from Amos chapter 8, 4 through 7. Hear this, you who trample on the needy and bring to ruin the poor of the land, saith, when will the new moon be over so that we may sell grain, and the Sabbath so that we may offer wheat for sale? We will make the ephah smaller and the shekel heavier, and practice deceit with false balances, buying the poor for silver and the needy for a pair of sandals, and selling the sweepings of wheat. The Lord has sworn by the pride of Jacob, surely I will never forget any of their deeds. The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Good morning, will you join in our opening hymn number 405, Seek Ye First.
Yeah.
Oh, I left out our celebrations. This week we are celebrating a couple of birthdays. Marina Markey and James Michael Holliday both have birthdays this week. And Floyd Polk is celebrating the anniversary of his membership to the church, as is Cynthia Fleming. So let's celebrate with those folks, these hallmarks in their lives. In our prayer request this morning, Justin Redden is asking for healing prayers. And most of you may know Beverly has fallen. It says broken arm, but I believe she had a broken shoulder. Is that correct?
Yes, or broke arm up near the shoulder area.
Or her arm up near the shoulder, okay. I know shoulder injuries are painful and slow healing, so let's keep Beverly in our prayers. It seems like she just got back to us in full strength, and now she's injured. So let's keep her in our prayers, both for her healing and her spirits.
Pastor Justin passed away last night.
My nephew. What was his first name?
Justin Redden.
Justin. Okay. So I mentioned the prayer request for Justin Redden. Justin passed away last night. So let's pray for the family, Fowlers and the Redden family, and as they go through this time of loss. I want to continue to pray for Corda Mendoza, the Owen family, who's mourning the loss of Mitch, Elizabeth Holliday, Miss Fagan. I want to continue to remember the families of those who were victims during the 9/11 catastrophe. We also want to continue to remember and pray for the families of the two police officers that were shot and killed here in Cobb County a couple of weeks ago. We also want to pray for the nation of England and for the family of Queen Elizabeth, as they have much to do to organize their lives and adapt to the changes. And she was such a steady and sturdy influence on the nation of England. We know that that entire country is in mourning over her loss. We want to pray, continue to pray for Katie, Francesca Asawa, who's traveling, Danny Smith, Ann Clackham, Anne-Marie and Dave, Barbara Casey, Becky Newton, Becky Sago, Carol Fuller, Camilla Munoz, Caroline, all those affected by the violence that has been rampant in our nation these past few years, Graham Sykes, Gene Kibler, John Dickerson, John Reagan, Larry Cooper, Margaret Hughes, Margaret Simpson, Marlo Keith, Norris Jones, people involved in the war in Europe, Phyllis, Sarah and Floyd Polk, Victor Blackstone, Wendy Tedder, and Willie Neal Kane. Does anybody have any special or request, anything that we haven't mentioned? Okay, we want to also, under celebrations, celebrate with Mitch Owen, who's gone home to be with his father. We can also celebrate with Queen Elizabeth, who has gone to be with the Lord. In addition to Queen, she served as the head of the church in England. We also want to celebrate with Scott McAfee, whose house is finally ready for him to live in. He actually has a house now. We want to celebrate with him. If nobody has anything to add, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Most gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you for all of your many blessings. For ourselves we seek but wisdom and clarity, that each and every day we may find your will for us in our lives. We ask you only for the power to carry that out. For those who we have named in our prayer requests, we ask your healing touch. We ask that you lend them strength and comfort and peace in their time of struggle. And we ask that you raise them up healed as only you can do. We ask that you grant wisdom to our leaders, both in the church and in our community and nation, that in their decision-making process they may find ways to please you as they attempt to lead us and direct us into the future. We pray that they make decisions that are in accordance with your will. We thank you for the way you have blessed our church, blessed our congregations that come here to worship. We thank you for all of those who minister to our congregation and to our community. We ask that you open our minds and ears that we may hear your word and that we may find your message for our own lives. We pray all of these things in the name of your Son, our Lord, Jesus Christ. Amen. If you would, please join me in the reading of our statement of faith. You will find the Apostles' Creed in the bulletin. It can also be found on page 881 of the United Methodist Hymnal. Please read with me. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead, he ascended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Thank you.
morning, our second scripture reading comes from the Gospel of Luke. It's Luke 16, verses 1 through 13. Actually, I added the next two verses to it when I finished preparing, but we'll get to that. So it's Luke 16, 1 through 13. Then Jesus said to the disciples, "There was a rich man who had a manager, and charges were brought to him that this man was squandering his property. So he summoned him and said to him, 'What is this I hear about you? Give me an account of your management, because you cannot be my manager any longer.' Then the manager said to himself, 'What will I do now that my master is taking the position away from me? I am not strong enough to dig, and I am ashamed to beg. I have decided what to do so that when I am dismissed as manager, people may welcome me into their homes.' So summoning his master's debtors one by one, he asked the first, 'How much do you owe my master?' He answered, 100 jugs of olive oil. So he said to him, 'Take your bill, sit down quickly, and make it 50. Then he asked another, "And how much do you owe?" And he replied, 100 containers of wheat. And he said to him, "Take your bill and make it 80. And his master commended the dishonest manager because he acted shrewdly, for the children of this age are more shrewd in dealing with their own generation than are the children of light. And I tell you, make friends for yourselves by means of dishonest wealth, so that when it is gone, they may welcome you into the eternal homes. Whoever is faithful in very little is faithful also in much, and whoever is dishonest in very little is dishonest also in much. If then you have not been faithful with the dishonest wealth, who will entrust to you the true riches? And if you have not been faithful with what belongs to another, who will give you what is your own? No slave can serve two masters, for a slave will either hate the one and love the other, or be devoted to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and wealth." The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
So, both of today's scriptures, both the one from Amos and the one from Luke, deal with greed, dishonesty, and mistreating the poor. Both contain some ideas and language that are a little difficult to follow. The Luke passage almost sounds like it's suggesting that you should be dishonest. And there's references in the Amos passage that we don't understand today. The first thing to understand is that, unlike the Pharisees, Jesus focused on the spiritual effects of the Jewish law rather than the physical details of obeying the law. In other words, Jesus was focused on the minds and hearts of the people, not necessarily every detail of what they did. And Jesus sought justice in the law. A few years ago, one of Atlanta's celebrity pastors, who I won't name, got into trouble with the Christian community in this area because he said that the Christian church should become unhitched from the Old Testament. And people said that he was saying that the Old Testament didn't matter. When he was questioned about it, he responded that he wasn't attacking the scripture, but he was referring to our freedom under Christ, because we're not bound by the law of Moses. Now, I'm not sure what he really meant by those statements, but what is important out of all of this is the heart of the person, not the adherence to the letter of the law. In Matthew 5:17, Jesus himself said, "Do not think that I have come to abolish the law or the prophets. I have not come to abolish them, but to fulfill them." And the New Living Translation even makes it even more clear. It says, "I came to accomplish their purpose." In other words, Jesus is saying that the law of the prophets and the law of Moses served a purpose, and that it was his duty to accomplish it, to fulfill it. Makes it clear that Jesus was here to examine and renew the hearts of the people, because that is so much more important than how many times you wash your hands every day, or whether you picked up an ounce over the weight limit on the Sabbath, or whether you ate something that you weren't supposed to eat. Psalm 78, verse 72 says, "He shepherded them with integrity of heart. With skillful hands he led them." So integrity of heart takes the precedence there. Integrity of heart is the sign of the good shepherd. So let's apply these ideas to today's scripture. In the passage from Luke, Jesus tells his disciples, "You cannot serve two masters. You cannot serve God and wealth." Now, the King James Version used the word mammon. I'm sure you've all heard that word used in a different translation or two, but it still refers to wealth. And this was an important message. We can't be 100% devoted to God and yet 100% devoted to some other cause. I never noticed before, until I was preparing for this sermon, how many of y'all have heard the parable of the prodigal son? Assume that would be everybody. How many of you have noticed that the parable on the prodigal son is actually about wealth? I've always focused on the behavior of the son, the behavior of the brother, the behavior of the father. Never really focused on the fact that the parable is actually a lesson about wealth, because it starts with the younger son asking for his share of his inheritance from his father. He can't wait till his dad dies. He wants his money now. He wants to be able to go and live life on his own the way he wants to live. In other words, he placed more value in the money than he did on his own family. until he ran out of money. When he ran out of money and had nothing to eat, he wasn't so much focused on what he had done wrong as he was focused on getting more from his father. When he came to his senses, he said, "How many of my father's hired servants have food to spare? And here I am starving to death." So he still focused on his physical needs. At first it was on wealth, and now it's on lack of wealth. Love of money applies to everybody, the rich and the poor. But it wasn't just the son who was focused on money. When his father saw him returning, how did he welcome him? He had him clothed in the finest robe. And he had a ring put on his finger. Both of these things were signs of wealth. And how did his older brother react? His older brother was mad that his father gave him a calf to celebrate with. He was jealous over the material wealth given to his younger brother that he felt like his younger brother hadn't earned. Money and wealth, wealth and money. You can kind of understand why the Bible says that the love of money is the root of all evil. It's actually from 1 Timothy chapter 6, verse 10. It says, "For the love of money is a root of all kinds of evil. Some people eager for money have wandered from the faith and pierced themselves with many griefs." So money can cost us our relationship with God. The lectionary which suggested these scriptures that we read today left out the next two verses from Luke. We only read through verse 13. Here's what 14 and 15 say. The Pharisees, who loved money, heard all this and were sneering at Jesus. And he said to them, "You are the ones who justify yourselves in the eyes of others, but God knows your hearts. What people value highly is detestable in God's sight." In other words, all of these earthly things that we feel like we have to have and that society thinks so highly of and uses to measure the value of people mean nothing to God, or less than nothing. It says it's detestable to God. I can remember in my 20s, I was single. I had a really well-paying career in the oil and gas industry. And I fell prey to the idea that wealth and money somehow made me more attractive or more important. It was important to me that people admire me. And I thought that meant that I had to have wealth and possessions. I don't know how many of y'all remember the 80s or the late 70s, but I drove a Cadillac. Kind of like the guys in that popular TV show of the time, Dallas. I wore expensive clothes, and I had 8 pairs of expensive cowboy boots. And I had a gold nugget this big around hanging on a chain around my neck. And I put a $4,000 stereo in that Cadillac so people could hear me going by. and it meant nothing. I was never satisfied. I had a good time a lot of the times, but most of that was misbehaving. And the things that are important in life, those possessions meant nothing. But it took me a long time to learn that. A reading from Amos, the Old Testament that we don't need anymore, according to that pastor, explains the kinds of evil that the love of money can create. Hear this, you that trample on the needy and bring ruin to the poor of the land, saying, when will the new moon be over so that we may sell grain, and the Sabbath so that we may offer wheat for sale? We will make the ephah small and the shekel great and practice deceit with false balances, buying the poor for silver and the needy for a pair of sandals, and selling the sweepings of the wheat. The Lord has sworn by the pride of Jacob, surely I will never forget any of their deeds. So the merchants and the wealthy of Israel, God's chosen people, were so anxious to make every last penny or shekel that they could, that they resented the Sabbath, the day of rest, because they weren't allowed to work on the Sabbath. They weren't allowed to put their employees to work on the Sabbath. They weren't allowed to sell their goods and make more money on the Sabbath. You may have noticed the reference to the new moon in most ancient Israel. The new moon was another time when you went to the temple to worship rather than working. They weren't allowed to sell their grain or their goods during the new moon as well. So they resented the fact that people had a day off and that they couldn't make money on those days. That wouldn't apply to any of us today at all, I'm sure. The ephah was a unit of measurement, and it was applied to grains and other goods. So if you were buying wheat, you would get an ephah of wheat, and it was supposed to be a standard measurement. And the shekel was the common use, the currency of usage. But many of the merchants would cheat the scales when measuring the ephah so that it was less than it was supposed to be. And then they would charge more for it. So they were giving less goods for more money. But people had to eat. And if the poor fell into debt to one of these merchants, and they couldn't pay their debt in a timely way, they could be put into slavery or indentureship until the debt was paid. So now, not only couldn't they pay their debt, but they were working for free. Couldn't feed their families or pay their other bills because they were having to work for free. And selling the sweepings of wheat, it's not an idea or a phrase that we're very familiar with. But it means that they were selling even the remnants that were inferior and not good for very much. So the poor were taken advantage of in every possible opportunity. Why is the Old Testament important? It's not because we as Christians are bound to the law of Moses. Jesus freed us from that But if we study the Old Testament, we find God's justice in it. We find not what God thinks of us doing a little work on the Sabbath. We see God's wish for our hearts and our minds. We see that God's justice extends to the poor, to those who are unfortunate, to those who are ill, to those who are needy. And we can see in many cases, not all cases, but in many cases, how the wealthy and the powerful, those who value wealth and power and buildings and earthly belongings over people, have no real sense of God's justice. They're all too ready to wield what they call justice as a weapon against the people. They have no real sense of God's justice. Social justice is a really important theme to today's society. There's all kinds of movements in our country to eradicate this injustice or that injustice. Try to make us more aware. I won't use that other word. But you see, the problem with culture's idea of justice is that in order to lift this group up, the only way they know how to do that is to push this group down. God's justice has no victims. You've heard me say that before. I promise you, you will hear me say it again. It's an idea that I'm still mulling over in my mind. It is so important that we understand God's justice has no victims. God does not need to abuse one group of people in order to lift another group of people up. God lifts all people up. Here's a notion from the Old Testament that we don't need anymore, that we should be applying to all of our businesses and jobs and careers, especially those that produce needed goods. It comes from Leviticus chapter 19, verses 9 through 16. Keep in mind, this is a Mosaic law that we don't need anymore. When you reap the harvest of your land, you shall not reap to the very edges of your field or gather the gleanings of your harvest. You shall not strip your vineyard bare or gather the fallen grapes of your vineyard. You shall leave them for the poor and for the alien. For I am the Lord your God. You shall not steal, and you shall not deal falsely, and you shall not lie to one another, and you shall not swear falsely by my name, profaning the name of your God. I am the Lord. You shall not defraud your neighbor. You shall not steal. And you shall not keep for yourself the wages of a laborer until morning. You shall not revile the deaf or put a stumbling block before the blind. You shall fear your God, for I am the Lord. You shall not render an unjust judgment. You shall not be partial to the poor or defer to the great. With justice you shall judge your neighbor. You shall not go around as a slanderer among your people. And you shall not profit by the blood of your neighbor. I am the Lord. Do not seek revenge or bear a grudge against anyone among your people. But love your neighbor as yourself. I am the Lord. Y'all probably all heard that last one somewhere. Love your neighbor as yourself. Do not seek revenge. That reminds me, I don't even remember who said it first. But it has been said that forgiveness is giving away your right for vengeance. You cannot serve two masters. You cannot serve God and money. Amen?
Our closing hymn is I Surrender All, is page 354 in the hymnal. After the fourth verse, Debbie will transpose the music to another key.
Oh,
Well, we finished before the Baptist this morning, so y'all won't be late for lunch. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace today and forevermore. Amen.
Amen.
Right, and you get the canvas, it's across.